Thank you, Brenda. Our next speaker is Khadija Sinanan, who's an attorney at law and co-director of feminist nonprofit organization Womantra. Khadija, during law school, volunteered with the non-governmental organization Aspire, Advocates for Safe Parenthood, Improving Reproductive Equity, where she began to gain valuable insights into the sexual reproductive health rights advocacy landscape. She continues to advocate for the improvement of women and girls' rights through her work at Womantra, and in 2013 was selected as one of Women Deliver's 100 Global Young Leaders, and in 2015 was selected by Women Deliver as a 2015 World Contraception Day Ambassador for Latin America and the Caribbean. It's always important for IGDS to mentor young voices, young feminist voices in the field, and so we're very glad to have Khadija Sinanan speak next.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Gabrielle, for the introduction. A very warm welcome to members of the coalition. Was very happy to hear the presentations made by Dona and Brenda. I think that we kind of fill in each other's gaps because they treated with a lot of the aspects of our coalition's recommendations that I maybe did not have the time to focus on through this presentation, which will treat primarily with the law, specifically as it relates to child marriage. So my presentation will focus on the legal perspectives and the advocacy that we've been doing so far as a coalition around the child marriage issue. So let's first take a look at the law. Several people have mentioned that there are four marriage acts in Trinidad and Tobago. And all of these acts, all of them, including the ordinary civil Christian marriage act, permit the marriage of minors. Every single one. So we have all four acts. The Marriage Act, which treats with marriages in Christian and civil unions. The Hindu Marriage Act, the Muslim Marriage and Divorce Act, and the Orisha Marriage Act. Now, dependent on the age of the child involved, the consent of their parents or legal guardian may be required by the law. And this is a point I really want us to focus on as we go through the presentation, because I think it is something that has easily been taken for granted in the national conversation, what these acts actually say and what they actually mean for young women and men, but more so young women. So we will look first at the oldest act, the Christian, well, the Marriage Act, which treats with civil or Christian marriages. It was passed in 1923, I believe, but commenced in 1924. Now, this act doesn't actively specify a minimum marriageable age. It doesn't say at 18 persons can contract into a marriage. It doesn't identify an age. But what it does do is identify a section which is headed age of consent for minors. So in this section, what it says is that it permits the marriage of minors provided that certain conditions are met. They're very extensive conditions, and they treat, of course, parental consent. In the ordinary Civil and Christian Marriage Act, the stipulations to permit the marriage of minors mandate that in the first instance, if both parents are alive and living together, both of them must consent. If they are living apart, the consent of the parent with whom the minor is living is required. If both parents are living apart and the minor does not live with either of them, both parents' consent is still required. However, a high court judge may dispense with one of the parents' consent. And finally, if one of the parents has passed away, consent is required from the surviving parent and any other person who is the legal guardian of the minor. If both parents have passed, the consent of the legal guardian is required. The important thing to note from this act is this is the general act. This is the act under which the majority of Trinidadians and Tobagonians who are not Hindu, Muslim, or Orisha would get married under. And it is this myth that exists that the ordinary act does not permit underage marriage, but it does. Whether it's exercised as much is a question to be debated, but it does permit minor marriage. The second act we're going to look at is the Hindu Marriage Act. It commenced in 1946. This is the part where I kind of need to pay a little more close attention, because it's something I also kind of realized in the course of doing some research. Now, the acts identify a marriageable age, which essentially say, at this age, persons of this faith can get married. So for the Hindu Marriage Act, for girls that age is 14, and for boys that age is 18. Understand that what that means is 14-year-olds and 18-year-olds may get married without the consent of their parents. which is something I think we didn't fully appreciate. They can't get married without the consent of their parents. The Act then goes on to say that if either of those parties are under the age, and well, it doesn't say if they want to get married, but if they're under the age, a marriage will only happen with parental consent. So what is happening there is that marriages under for girls under the age of 14 and boys under the age of 18 are permitted with parental consent. It gets even more interesting, and Gabby alluded to this. Not only the disparity between the ages at which boys and girls may on their own enter a marriage, boys at 18, girls at 14, but when underage persons, in the context of this act, are getting married with parental consent, the consent required is firstly that of the father. Not both mother and father. The first consent required is that of the father. The father has passed, then the legal guardian's consent is required. Not the mother, the legal guardian. If the legal guardian is unavailable or has passed, then the mother's consent is required. And if the mother has passed, then on an application, a person may be appointed by the president for this purpose. So again, the key point to take away from this is that within each act, there has been established a marriageable age, which is the age at which a person may get married without consent. And then subsequent to that, persons who are under those ages are permitted to be married with parental consent, which I think is even more concerning because we are talking here about persons under the age of 14 and under the age of 18 who may be married without parental consent, and there's no minimum age identified in the legislation. Similarly, with the Muslim Marriage Act, it's the same structure, so I'm not going to go through it in the same amount of detail, but the marriageable age for which no consent is required is 16 for boys and 12 for girls. In the Orisha Marriage Act, the marriageable age for boys is 18 and for girls it is 16. And those are all acts. So this is the legislative reality that we're treating with when we talk about child marriage and what changes need to be made. We really need to understand in a comprehensive way what obtains in the law. It took a few reasons on my part to really understand how this functions and to comprehend what actually obtains with respect to the consent, because all of the elements, the disparity in the ages for boys and girls, the parents who may or may not give consent, tell us something about how gender happens in the law and how the law enacts particular forms of gender or ways of being a man and a woman. So it's interesting to note, and it's something obviously that we have to consider before we then go on to the next question of what do we do next and what needs to be changed in order for us to move on to the next approach to amend these laws and bring them in line with the principles we all seek to have enacted. Key amendments, what needs to be changed? Well, I think we have a lot of consensus on this. We have had the discussions in the room. Brenda did an excellent assessment of how we've gotten to this point. And the coalition's position is that the marriageable age needs to be raised to 18 years and standardized across all of the acts. We don't need to get into a lot of legalities to understand this is the position we want. This is the key amendment that needs to be made in order for us to come to the position that we need to come to. This amendment will make the marriageable age consistent with the age of consent identified in the Children's Act. Dona very aptly pointed out the controversy that surrounded those amendments when the Children's Act was proclaimed, when particular sections of the Children's Act were proclaimed in 2015. But as we know, what obtains presently, the definition of child in Trinidad and Tobago is 18 years, with the amendments made to the Children's Act. And consistent with that, where we would like to see the marriageable age across all of the acts raised to that standard. Well, again, under this act, child is defined as a person under the age of 18. Making the changes happen. Now, we spent a lot of time at the coalition discussing this at great length. And as Brenda pointed out, we are working with social media. We're using all of these different avenues to actually make change. The consultations by the Attorney General were very encouraging. And what he indicated was that a draft bill has been prepared. It's called the Miscellaneous Provisions Marriage Bill 2016, and that it would be passed before the end of this month. A draft bill has not been made public to date, and we eagerly await maybe if we could have some feedback from the Attorney General's representatives in the room as to, you know, what is the status of the act. because it is definitely something that we want to see passed before the end of the year. Again, in order for this bill to be effective, it must include provisions which increase and standardize the marriageable age across the various acts, and also mandate that marriage officers observe the marriageable age and face appropriate penalties for the breach of these provisions. What was interesting to note at the Attorney General's consultations is that, well, first of all, he provided us with extremely valuable data on what is actually happening with child marriage in Trinidad and Tobago, which is something that I think most of the parties at the table did not have the benefit of seeing before. What he did note is that, I guess in the course of conducting the research and obtaining that data, it did not represent the fullness of what is taking place with marriages in Trinidad and Tobago. There was evidence that maybe some marriages were not recorded properly, some marriages were not recorded at all. So this data is what we know, but it's not everything. And there's a real need to ensure that we've made the changes, the law has been passed, and we're at that stage. We haven't done the cultural work of shifting people's mindsets towards this issue, that despite the change in the law, that people actually adhere to the change in the law and understand why it's important. And a penalty can be preventive. But on to the next slide. Why change the law? Really, this is a question that you would think we lost on this room. We all understand why we need to change the law, but amazingly, it remains a question we need to discuss in the public. Simply put, child marriage violates girls' rights to health, education, and opportunity. It exposes girls to violence throughout their lives and traps them in a cycle of poverty. This is the most apt way in which to capture the various aspects and elements of damage that can happen to a girl if she goes through this ritual of child marriage. It is not just a matter of she will not finish school or she may not get the chance to graduate. Health, education, opportunity, and poverty are the dimensions to this issue that we really need to pay attention to and take into account when we look at the fullness of the picture. The myths. In advocating against the issue of child marriage in Trinidad, the coalition has consistently, and the nation, have been privy to a lot of the perspectives of different religious groups on the realities of child marriage. And it's important, if we are to be serious about addressing this issue, to pay particular attention at what is being said and to address it accordingly. There were no child brides, so these are a couple of the myths. There were no child brides in Trinidad and Tobago over the past 2 years. That quote from Satmara, Secretary General of ASCMS. Another quote, what is the evidence that child marriage is a problem in Trinidad and Tobago? There is no evidence that child marriage is a problem. Why are we discussing this? This is from Senator Razi Ahmed, former Minister of Gender. And as much as it is amusing to see these things here, these are real sentiments that people have shared in public as existing. And honestly, to the first one, some people generally do not think child marriage is happening in Trinidad and Tobago. A lot of people that have not been involved in the advocacy, and even people who have been, were very surprised to know the extent to which it was taking place. Because it's not something that's discussed, it's something that happens in a faraway place, in an extremist country, and it doesn't happen in our backyards in sweet sunny Trinidad and Tobago, but it has been taking place. So let's look at some of the facts. 51 child marriages were recorded in 2014. 10 marriages were recorded in 2015. I pointed out these two particular years because, as the myth said, there were no child brides in TNT over the past 2 years. In fact, there were. And then, of course, what is the evidence of child marriage is a problem in Trinidad and Tobago? Well, let's see. 72 girls were legally married in Trinidad in 2007. 72 girls. This is the number just recorded for that year, 2007. 3 girls have been married since the start of this year alone, 2016. Child marriages have not abated. The numbers fluctuate depending on the year when you look at the data, but they are happening, they are taking place. And the question that, the number we need to be paying attention to, and the question that I have asked myself in looking at this data and looking at the myths, is how many more child marriages need to happen before we say that this is an issue? Because people have very glibly said this is not a problem, these are 3 lives. It may not be the biggest, most exciting number, but these are three girls who have lives, who have been married at a very young age. Which is another interesting thing to note about the data, because as Gabby mentioned, what is a child has been an active question in this debate. The SDMS has found a favorable argument in looking at them as teenage marriages, because they're sort of more mature, which is true, teenagers are more mature. But unfortunately, we have, by his definition, a lot of child marriages happening in Trinidad and Tobago. 8 14-year-old girls were married in 2006. 14-year-old girls. These are girls who some of them haven't even gone through puberty yet. 17, 13-year-old girls were married in 2010. A 12-year-old girl was legally married in Trinidad in 2006. And the next year, another 12-year-old girl was legally married. This is not a teenager. And this is also, as much as it is not the biggest statistic, these are individual girls, whose lives have been changed permanently because of the fact that this is legally permissible under our laws. One moment, I'm coming to the end of the presentation. This one is something I really wanted to focus on, and Gabby alluded to it. Teenage pregnancy. The issue of teenage pregnancy and child marriage, they are connected, but not necessarily in the way that they've been discussed in the media. So this comes from the president of Gopeesingh. If laws to be passed to outlaw marriages under the age of 18 when a young lady becomes pregnant at the age of 15, what will take place? And trust me, you will get massive suicides. Is that what we want for our children, or do we want in common terminology to patch it up and get her married? If it says she commits suicide, the father of that child would also have committed an offense of statutory rape. He would be going to jail. There's so many issues packed into this statement. There's so much in here that it's a challenge. This might take us some time. But the fear-mongering that he attempts to do, this mass suicide that would supposedly happen in Trinidad and Tobago, if we protect young girls and not go on to marry them, in very many cases, to the men who have abused them. The fact that he asks almost a rhetorical question at the end here, the father of that child would have also committed an offense of statutory rape, he will be going to jail. Duh! He should be going to jail. He has committed an offense. And what is particularly interesting to note is that we have a lot of data, which is what we use to develop these very nice slides. And they feature the ages of the girls. We're grateful for the data from the Office of the Attorney General, but they don't actually indicate the ages of the men. I'm not sure why, maybe the office could finish us, but on the form that you have to declare when you're getting married, it is recorded, the age of the man, the age of the woman or girl. So it would be interesting to know what these statistics actually look like. So let's just kind of unpack this a little bit. Child marriage is not a solution to teen pregnancy. We need to make this abundantly clear because apparently it needs to be said. These are a couple of countries. Since 2011, Azerbaijan, Chad, Ecuador, Kenya, Malawi, Turkmenistan, as well as the same province of Pakistan, all increased the age of marriage to 18. A number of other countries have removed parental consent exceptions which allowed marriage under 18. As of August 2016, at least 8 countries have launched national strategies to address child marriage. Teenage pregnancy, as we know, happens in all of these places. Every single one of them is a serious problem in most of them. As ridiculous as it is, even after point this out, there have been no mass suicides. There's no correlation. And I would be very interested to see how somebody could possibly defend that kind of statement. But we continue. And now what is more, because before we go into the next slide, is that this statement is couched very interestingly, almost as if you're concerned about the girl. Like, this is the angle that the president has decided to take. These girls may commit suicide. Let's look a little bit at what actually happens to girls who get married very young. First of all, 90% of adolescent pregnancies in the developing world are to girls who are already married. Is there a problem, perhaps, of girls who have become married, who have become pregnant, and then they may want to get married, or the parents may decide it's necessary for them to get married? Yes, that may be a phenomenon. But a large part of pregnancies are happening within marriages to underage brides. 90% of adolescent pregnancies in the developing world, and I think it is something to note, because it kind of disputes this myth that the pregnancy happens first and then the marriages are band-aid that you put on it to solve the problem. When in reality, these girls are getting married and are becoming pregnant at a point in time, as Donna pointed out, when their bodies are not physically capable of carrying a baby to term. In most cases, child marriage is a driver of early pregnancy. In other cases, marriage follows a girl's often unwanted pregnancy. But complications in pregnancy and childbirth are consistently among the leading cause of death in girls aged 15 to 19 in low and middle income countries. If we want to have a serious conversation about maternal mortality and infant mortality, it's interesting that we have so many cases of that happening in Trinidad and Tobago. We have not really taken the time to address that, but you use it as a jump off argument to undermine an initiative to remove a very dangerous practice, when in reality, child marriage and the phenomenon of child marriage, which would allow very young girls to become pregnant within a marriage, have caused a lot of actual deaths. And if you look at the maternal mortality statistics in Trinidad and Tobago and in Latin America and the Caribbean, it's in very large part young women from poor and developing regions. When a mother is under 20, her child is 50% more likely to be stillborn or die within its first weeks of life than a baby born to an older mother. This is equally important because once again, the argument made in favor of child marriage is in defense of a child and a mother. When we think about the argument that connects to teen marriage, it's in defense of a child and an unborn, a teen mother and an unborn child. When the reality, unfortunately, is that underage mothers, young mothers, are in a far more dangerous position when it comes to pregnancy. And the solutions to treating with those situations are not a marriage of girls, that's not a medical intervention. We need to start thinking a lot more critically about how we educate young people, boys and girls, and the services that we provide to them, which I think have been really aptly described by Donna in her presentation. Girls who are married early are more likely to be abused sexually, physically, and emotionally. And I think this is a part of the conversation that we haven't even started to look at in a qualitative sense yet, because we have all of this data and all of these numbers, and it really does not feature at all a human experience. And what that does sometimes, it makes people feel comfortable to say things like, well, it's not a few. It's not a few, which is basically the position of Senator Ahmed. It's not a few people, so it's not that big of an issue, so we don't need to pay attention. But these are real lives, and we don't have the benefit of qualitative information to let us know what has been the lived experience of a person who at 11 got married and then had to live a full life, an adult woman's life that started at 11. What happens to you when you don't have a childhood, when you didn't finish school? These little things, you didn't have a grad. Like, all the little things that people may take for granted as instances of childhood along our timeline that you've just been robbed of, because you have not only been married to this person and given over to them sexually, but your domestic servant essentially for the rest of your life. A lot of these women don't have the opportunity to go on and further themselves. But the point to be made is that this is almost all we can see at this point, because we haven't even really started to think about in a personal way what it means to women who have had this experience and what their experience actually looks like. And we really need to factor that in when we're having the conversation, even if we don't have the information. This is going to give my last statistic. A study carried out in two states of India showed that girls who married before 18 reported experiencing physical violence twice as often and sexual violence three times as often as girls who married at a later age. And once again, the statistics paint a particular picture which is extremely dire. And these statistics aren't Trinidad and statistics, which we don't have them. We haven't even really started to think about what have the experiences of our girls been. The 569 girls that were married in the past 10 years, where are they now? And what have they experienced? And what are we going to do to protect the next 600 girls that may be married in the next 10 years? Act now. And this is where we have arrived at the coalition, trying before the end of this year to push the government to pass the act in parliament, make it public, give persons the opportunity to comment on it, and pass the bill and actually end child marriage legally by 2016. So I have a small call to action, because this is also activist space, not just to discuss the legal perspectives. We need to ensure that the government keeps its promise and passes this bill. At one of the consultations, there was an Orisha leader who stood up and he commented that he had been at a similar consultation 16 years ago.
In the same room.
And it was striking, like 16 years ago, I don't even remember what I was doing. It's just insane to me that this has been happening for so long. And despite the most ardent efforts of the Hindu Women's Association, of all of these different pockets of activism, it has somehow managed to not be changed. What is essentially low-hanging fruit? This is not something that the public is of two minds about. Generally, we have the sense in the public that this needs to change, but somehow, despite the fact that some of these laws were passed in 1925, we cannot seem to get the government to the final stage of changing it, and this is what we're trying to do now, before the end of the year, within the next 3 months. So we encourage everyone to write letters, tweet, support the coalition, and get the word out. I think one of the biggest myths has been the one espoused by Senator Ahmed, the sense that it isn't happening, and therefore it's not as important. The sense that it may be an attack on people's culture, a more defensive response. And it helps, I think, to contextualize this for people and have them understand this is not unique to any religion or any faith in Trinidad and Tobago. It happens, it is permissible under all of the acts, including the Non-Religious Act, the act that governs the majority of the unions people see as their typical marriage. This is not a movement to end Hindu child marriage or to end Muslim child marriage. It's a movement to end child marriage. And I think when people kind of get around to the fact that let's focus our attention on the actual persons who are the victims in this situation and not those who are kind of capitalizing on the moment to kind of push the conversation in different directions, it leads to a different result in your conversation. So we encourage everyone to try and push the conversation in all of your spaces. We're at the stage now where we want to focus a lot on reaching out to MPs and letting them know this has happened in your constituency. We have the data, it's on the Attorney General's website, where you can see how many marriages happened in Dabedi, how many marriages happened in Toko, how many marriages happened in whatever regions. Tweet your MP, let him know this 17 marriages happened here, and I think you should vote and end this practice. So this is the stage where I'm encouraging everyone to come on board and use your spaces and your voices to agitate more, and let's actually see this passed before the end of the year. You can check out Romantra, Winad, Hindu Women's Association, CAISO, lots of different organizations. Check out their Facebook presence and you'll learn more about the coalition and the campaign. And that's the end of my presentation. Thank you very much.